Hi, I'm Stanford Moore with Black Reins Magazine and 108 Praise. We have some great cowboys right here. We're at the first annual Columbus, Georgia Black Rodeo, and we got some of our great contestants here. Tell us who you are.
Colton Turner.
Cliff Allred.
Brandon Carter.
All right. So any one of you guys, tell us what you do, what your responsibilities are as far as from each other, and what's your part do you take place in this rodeo?
I'm a bull rider. Come out and help our buddies out and just haul together and have fun.
Just here, just living a dream and, man, just having fun, riding bulls, doing what I love and doing it with my best friends. It couldn't get better than that.
I'm the bullfighter. I keep these guys safe and everybody else, and I like stepping around them. It's fun.
So how important it is to have somebody as your wingman to this guy? Do you trust this guy? Is this a good friend of yours?
Yes.
That you get? Because I'm telling you, that's a big responsibility, right?
We first started hauling back when we was 13 years old. He started riding, and here a couple of years, he wanted to start fighting, but I trust him with my life. He's took many hookings for me, so, yeah, I trust him.
Absolutely. So, look, you're the bull rider, and that's a big deal. I mean, tell us about the toughness it takes and how long and what gave you the decision to want to ride bulls.
I guess since I've been a little kid, I always looked at guys wearing belt buckles, and I seen the bull rider, and I rode bucking horses when I was a little kid. And one day told my mom I want to ride bulls, took me to the practice pen, got on, got slammed, face full of mud, got back up, wanted to do it again, and been hooked ever since.
Hooked ever since. And is this how you all guys met?
Yes, sir.
That's unbelievable. Now, who convinced the other that this is what we're going to do?
I was a beginner and convinced them all. Worst decision they ever made.
He told me, he said it was a dare. He dared me to do it, and I went to the practice pen at Litcher's and them in Jackson, Tennessee. He told me, he said, I bet you tried and see if you like it. Well, I tried it, and I got hooked to riding, and I went from riding to protecting. So
absolutely, man. And what about yourself?
My uncle rode bulls, my whole family rodeoed, so I just went in, did the family thing.
So look, this is a Christian radio station, and it takes a certain amount of faith. One thing I know about the Southern hospitality, the Southern guys, that you all got a good foundation about you. Usually come from good stock, good people, good family people, good manners. Tell us about that, about what you see yourself as a man and your inspiration and just being a role model for the next generation.
Man, just going out there and helping your buddies. And, you know, before we climb on back at Buck and Shoot, we don't know if that's going to be our last ride or not. And we all say our prayers. We know the right from wrong. We know the good Lord's coming back. And, I mean, I can't wait to see him again. And I just having fun. Thank God that he gives me this opportunity and this ability to go down the road and do this, because times are hard and money's hard to come by, and it's just a blessing. And when people see that and they see that you're riding on faith, I mean, that just spreads the word of God, so it couldn't be no better than that.
Absolutely, man. That's what I love to hear, man. It's just so much craziness going on in the world, and I just like to see you guys that still represent of just being good people, man, and getting out there working hard, doing what you do, and it takes a level of faith, and you guys put on a great show, and it's one of the toughest sports in the world. Trust me, I don't know too many people that can brag and say they're tougher than you guys, and I'm just so glad to be a part of it. Glad that you guys put on an awesome show. What's your next event? What's coming up for you guys?
We really don't know. I just look on the computer right now because all the finals are kind of coming up. I'll find somewhere next weekend that probably could be in Mississippi, could be in Kentucky. Really don't kind of play it by ear right now.
Bulls on the beach.
Bulls on the beach. So, look, how far do you guys want to go with this? How far you want to go?
I want to make a career. I want to be a world champion. I've been trying hard for it for a lot of years, and I feel this is my year, and I'm at my peak, and yeah. I'm just going to let it rock and roll.
Good stuff, man. I mean, great stuff. And the thing is, man, I tell you, I don't think people get to see guys like you enough. And when you talk about real heroes and hard times, I always tell people all the time, you think you got a bad day. You know, check out some of these guys. And you guys take it well. Yeah. So, look, it's an honor to be with you guys. You know, check us out. 108 Praise, Black Reins TV, Black Reins Magazine. Find us on the web. And for everybody out here, you just met three studs right here. They just got it done. Three studs. There ain't no Geldens in this group. These are all studs. And we're so glad and honored to catch up with you guys. And hopefully we see you one day in Vegas.
Yes, sir.
All right. Hi. We're back again. This is Stanford Moore with Black Reins Magazine. We're with 108 Praise. Proud to bring you one of the top cowboys here in Columbus, first annual Columbus Black Rodeo. Who do we have here today?
Sir, my name is Ronnie Wright. I'm from Oklahoma.
Ronnie Wright, all the way from Oklahoma. What brings you, other than this, all the way to Columbus? How did you end up coming here? Tell us a little bit about how you got invited and what events you participate in.
Well, I participate in ranch bronc riding, team roping, and bull riding, and I kind of, you know, going to other rodeos, and some guys are like, hey, they're having a deal down there in Columbia, Georgia, so we just loaded up, and we decided to head across that state line, and we had a drive ahead of us, and we got a drive back tonight, but that's what you do when you rodeo.
So you drove all the way across?
Drove all the way from Oklahoma.
You and a team or by yourself?
Me and a team. We actually went to another rodeo last night in Arkansas, and after that rodeo was over, we boogied on out and headed here.
So is this your full-time gig, and that's what you do?
I'm trying to make it a full-time deal. I'm trying to cut back on work. Just really getting back into it. I dealt with some injuries in the past that helped me out for about two years. And just coming back and coming on strong.
Talk about that. Talk about how, you know, this is a tough sport. You're talking about bronc riding. You're talking about bull riding. And I consider just the whole rodeo circuit is one of the toughest sports in the world. Facing, you know, you're inevitably going to be faced with some injuries. Talk about that, knowing you're going to face that, and what mindset it takes to get back on the bull.
It's faith and ability, you know. It's faith and just knowing that I got a God up above that's going to look after me. And, you know, before I get on that bull, before I swing that rope, I fall on my knees and I ask the good Lord. I said, Lord, please keep me near the cross. Keep me safe. This is what I love to do. I'm not afraid to pay the price.
Absolutely, man. We love to hear that because it takes a level of confidence, man. Talk about your family. And did you come from a family of cowboys? Or how did you get involved in this competition?
Well, I grew up on a ranch back in southern Oklahoma. My grandpa worked it for 37 years, and he was just an old ranch hand. He team roped, and he used to take me to the little town rodeo every year when I was a kid, about five. Well, from the day I was old enough to being born, I was going to rodeos, and he just hauled me all in. And I was a spectator then, so now I always said, Grandpa, when I grow up, I want to be this, I want to be that. But everything that I want to be, a calf roper and all that, I hadn't seen to go through that yet. I tried it in a pasture and pretty decent at it, but never in an arena. So I fell off in the bull riding from other family members. I had a cousin that was probably 12 years old. He grabbed me up and took me in his wing, took me to a rodeo. He said, boy, you want to ride a bull? I said, yeah. And he was like, you think you're tough enough? And I said, yeah. And first bull I drew, I almost rode him. Got up and limped away. Next bull I went to, he thumped my head, and I kind of got shook up and scared. But I kept mine strong, kept trying to go to it until I dealt with it and got all the butterflies out of my system.
Wow, good deal. Because I was going to ask you and lead in to who's your inspiration, who's your mentor. You just don't learn this stuff. There should be somebody to guide you through the ranks. So who's been your greatest inspiration and mentor?
One of my greatest inspirations is, it's a guy I don't know him really well. I've been around him quite a bit. His name is Donnell Tipton. He's one of my heroes of cowboy. I mean, he's a living legend bull riding. He's a two-time NFR qualifier and 1995 world champion. And I look up to that guy, and I give that guy so much respect because, I mean, he's everything that I want to be right now.
Definitely, man. Definitely. Where do you see yourself in a few years? I mean, you're putting in the work. You did a great job tonight. I see you, you know, as far as your competition, you definitely fulfilled everything that we came out to see. Where do you see yourself in a few years?
Nothing other than being a cowboy. I want to be, I want world titles and stuff, you know, but if I don't get it, I'm going to enjoy each and every rodeo I go to.
Absolutely, man. Yeah, but definitely. And, you know, I look at guys like yourself, you know, for all the young kids that want to get into a sport like this, what advice can you give them?
It takes guts, and You gotta, you know, go with the glory and faith of God. And if you want to do it, you give it all. You give it your all, because that animal, he's giving it his all every time you crawl on him. And to be good, you gotta want to be, you gotta want to compete, but you gotta have fun doing it. You can't take it too serious.
Absolutely. And you know what? That's a definitely a good motto for life, because I think, you know, as we watch the media and now everything that's going on in the world right now, I think the world's just a little too tight, right? A little too serious. They need to come out to a rodeo and see guys like you to relieve some of that pressure. I always say, you think you're having a bad day, you know, imagine these guys, you know, wake up with the bumps and bruises to show for it. But look, we're so honored and glad to catch up with you, man. You know, on behalf of 108 Praise and Black Reins Magazine, we love what you do. We love what you bring to the country as far as entertainment, and I'm so proud to call you a brother, man. What a great time, man. So glad to catch up with you. All right, thank you so much. All right, Stanford Moore here with Black Reins Magazine and 108 Praise. We're honored to bring to you one of these champion cowgirls right here of the Columbus Black Rodeo, actually the first annual Columbus Black Rodeo here in Columbus, Georgia. Who do we have here with us today?
Coriana Burkhalter.
Coriana Burkhalter. That's a big name in rodeo. That's a family that's getting it done. So tell us a little bit about who you are, what event you ride.
Well, I'm 16. I live in Oklahoma City, and I run burros, and I go to school. That's pretty much it.
Okay, good deal. You play basketball, too?
A little bit.
Oh, it takes a little athleticism to do what you do. And how long have you been riding horses?
Since I was 6 years old.
6 years old. What inspired you to do the barrel race?
Well, my dad had started me, and I just kept watching it on TV, and that's what got me here.
Okay. Hey, good deal. And, I mean, you did it so well. And I know a lot of girls, a lot of young ladies that want to get into this type of sport. Tell us what type of discipline it takes and focus and practice it takes to come out here and do what you do.
It takes patience, and you got to just take your time, and you can't rush.
No, well, good deal. I mean, that was a lot of attributes that you can take to life. And every time I come across people that's doing what you do, usually they have that calm, like you have demeanor about you. And tell us who your biggest inspiration was.
Sherry Servey.
Sherry Servey. Who is she?
She's a professional burro racer.
Okay. So, I mean, where do you see yourself going in a few years? I know you're not doing this just for fun, because you look like you're preparing to take it very serious. What do you see yourself going in a few years?
I want to be up there in professional level and keep going.
Okay. I mean, do you seek any type of schooling outside? Because, I mean, I know you're getting trained at home. And do you go to any type of camps or schools around the country, or do you just participate in rodeos?
I just participate in rodeos.
Okay, good deal. So you say you're 16. Tell us about school, and how does this affect school? What do the people in school have to say about you getting out here taking on these horses and barrels?
Well, people in school, they just keep asking me, do you want to, can I ride and stuff like that? And I'd be like, yeah, sure, just come on. And
Well, good deal. I mean, you represent so well. You're definitely a lady. I love the way you carry yourself. Everything about what you're doing right now, whether you know it or not, you're a role model. Because as you see, those fans will fill with thousands of individuals in there. I think it's always every little girl's story to ride a horse and have a pony or a pony at a party. And as a young role model, 16 years old, you're in school, you're doing positive things, you're keeping your head clean, staying out of trouble. What inspiration do you have for as being a role model for the young girls going forward?
Well, stay out of trouble. Do what you want to do. Chase your dreams.
Chase your dreams. Well, look, you're doing a big deal with that. I mean, I love everything about you. I've been watching you from afar in here. And as a young lady, I think just got a great foundation with you. And I know you got a family of some strong genes, them Burkhalters. And we're just so glad to catch up with you here, and looking forward to seeing you at the next rodeo doing big things and bringing that time down just a little bit, right? You did a great job. Well, look, honored to have you. And once again, we thank you guys. Burkhalter, good bloodline, 108 Praise, Black Reins Magazine. Stanford Moore here with Black Reins Magazine and 108 Praise. It's an honor to catch up with one of the true cowboys. And I know everybody knows this name from around the country, but I want him to introduce himself.
My name is Billy Ray Thunder.
Billy Ray Thunder. You can Google it. Pull it up. When you say true cowboy, this guy usually is finding himself right beside that image in that picture. Well, Billy Ray Thunder, what do you think about this first annual Columbus Black Rodeo that you had here tonight?
Well, I thought it was awesome. I mean, they just really enjoyed it, and I just thank all the fans and stuff for coming. It was educational for a lot of them because a lot of people did not realize that they were black cowboys and cowgirls.
So. Absolutely, man. And it's just so an honor for me to know you personally and just know what an inspiration you are to the young generation of kids. You had a lot of young teenagers up in them stands today that probably wish they could do and had the longevity that you had. Tell us a little bit about you being a role model now at this stage in your career.
Well, first of all, I'm going to say this here. I don't drink. I don't smoke. And if you're really going to be an athlete, the one thing that I would recommend that my father told me is that you have to stay in the gym. You don't have to be John Atlas, but you have to stay in that gym and work out. You have to keep your body in shape because when you take some bad falls or get some bad breaks, it usually takes about 15 pounds of pressure to break a bone. But if you stay in that gym and work out, it'll increase to 17 pounds of pressure.
Absolutely. And, you know, from everything that we're doing now, as far as this black rodeo, taking this thing across the country, what would you like to see more of? You got average everyday people. You got a lot of guys at barns today thinking about getting into buying horses, riding horses, or into the sport. What advice you have for just a novice person? Like, we had a lot of them sitting in these stands and going to be watching this tape. What advice you have for them?
I would say that, you know, if you look around now, your neighborhoods and stuff, they have taken down all the basketball courts. When we used to go out and just all the kids would be outside, they weren't playing computers and stuff. Obeseness is just running rapid. Pregnancies are running rapid and everything. But if you get your child involved in a sport and we can teach them to rodeo, and if they're in high school or junior high, there are such things as I don't want to say things, but there are organizations such as high school rodeo. I don't care what state you stay in. Everybody in the West, they know about it because they get their children involved in it. You compete in high school rodeo. You compete for money and scholarships. My son just competed in Wyoming and they gave him $1,000 to get out there. He won the South Carolina high school championship, and he was the only black.
Wow. Plug him. What's his name?
His name is Andrew Capala.
Andrew.
He's the only black in this competition. He blew him out the water, and he is only a freshman. And he competed against all these seniors and whooped them all. College scouts were coming up to him, and they were saying, wow, you know, I want you to come to my college and everything. And he had to tell them, I'm just a freshman.
Wow. And you know, when you're talking about that, your mentor, when you see yourself and what you poured into young Andrew, look, there's a lot of men. I see a lot of negativity on Facebook and in the media today and the news. There's always some tragedy going on. And everything I've known about you, I don't care what nobody else say, but you've always been a Southern gentleman and that Southern hospitality. And really a guy that I see, I follow you. There's a lot of women look up to. Just the gentleman you are. Everybody seems to have some good things to say. Tell us about that.
My mom just raised me right. I'm native black American. My mom is Huron and black. My father was Erie and black. And I was just raised right, and I was taught to respect women. Because without women, you would not have, none of us would be here.
Good deal, ladies and gentlemen. I mean, this is what we're lacking today, just true tough men. We talking about somebody with grit, toughness, getting it done. How long have you been doing this?
I went to the military first. I'm 61 years old. And I started riding bulls in 1988, and I stopped riding about maybe 3 years ago, but I ride bucking horses now. So,
how many other people do you know have been doing it as long as you and still doing it?
Everybody that was younger than me that started, they're amazed that I'm still doing it, but I'm blessed, you know, from the Heavenly Father. And like I said, I stay in the gym. I work out. I don't put no bad things in my body, no alcohol, no drugs or anything like that. And I just try to do the best I can.
Well, you said it, Heavenly Father. It takes some serious prayer and some faith to do what you do. And you've been doing it well, man. And I'm so honored to call you one of the representations of the last good stock of good cowboys out there, setting a great example, man. And, any last words you want to leave people with?
I just want to say when the rodeo gets ready to come to your town, please bring your kids. It's a family event. And if you're interested in finding out how that you can get your kids in rodeo or something, just go on the internet and pull up high school rodeo. And if you're any place around the Atlanta area, you know, you can get in contact with me. I'm on Facebook also. And, you know, I have no problem with teaching your child.
Absolutely, guys. You heard it from one of the greats, Mr. Billy Ray Thunder. This is Black Reins Magazine, 108 Praise. We're here bringing you great stories from great cowboys here in Columbus, Georgia. All right? Thank you so much. Once again, you're back. Black Reins Magazine. My name is Stanford Moore. I'm here with 108 Praise. We're doing interviews of some of these top cowboys here in Columbus, Georgia at the first annual Black Rodeo here in Columbus, Columbus, Georgia. Who do we have here today?
Harold Miller.
Tell us about who you are. What sports?
Hey, I'm from South Carolina. I've been rodeoing probably 35 years for a living. You know, training horses and shoeing horses and rodeoing. I love it. I like meeting people. It was a good turnout here in Columbus, Georgia, and I hope they have it again.
Yes, sir. I mean, when they bring in great talent in like you guys, they definitely, I'm sure a lot of people will want to come back. Well, look, in Columbus, Georgia, you came out, you saw the crowd. What do you think you left the people here with today?
Oh, I left them with something they can think about on the Black Cowboys that they, you know, they don't advertise much around here. So now they know what's going on.
For the novice people, I mean, we're bringing this thing here to Columbus, Georgia. For the average person sitting in this stand that never seen a show like this, tell them what it takes to be a cowboy, what type of discipline and focus it takes to come to a sport and do a sport like this.
Oh, it takes, you got to get your head right. You have to get a lot of mental and physical stuff going on because they don't really know, you know, what it takes. You get on one of those wild horses and your adrenaline gets flowing and he blows out of there and you got to get to that front end before you got to beat him to the ground before you get there. You don't want to be late on that deal. So it just takes a lot out of a cowboy.
Now, I mean, you've been doing this for 35 years now, say. How did you ever even get involved in this type of sport?
I was breaking horses for people and stuff like that. And rodeo kind of my hometown, I got in it. And luckily, I won it, and I've been going ever since.
But look, tell us about this rope you got on. I see this rigging you got. Yeah. Break that down to the novice, everyday person. There's a whole lot of people think they know cowboys, yeah, but they see a rope like that, they don't even know what it is.
Uh-uh. This is a 9-plat with a 5-plat handhold on it, bull rope. It's nylon with leather all the way through the handhold. When you put this on the bull and run it through your loop and pull it tight, it goes down in his back and holds your hand, it helps hold your hand in there, keep from that old bull jerking out, because them bulls are strong. If you ain't got enough rawls on them and sticky on it, they'll jerk your hand out of that rope pretty easy. So, and that bale, they say that's to keep the cowboys awake. That's really to take, when you jump off, that's really just to take the rope off the bull.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Now tell me about that rigging, because I know when you talk about bronc riding and you talking about bull riding, talk about that, break down that rigging.
Yeah, that rigging is you wear your hand in it, and on the way your hand, if you got it right, on the way your hand come out if it goes down. When it's going from you, it's going to tighten up. So really, people don't think the bareback riding is dangerous as the bulls. But bareback riding is dangerous. When you hang up on the rigging, you hung up. They got to stop the horse, or either your rigging is going to slide up under him. And I've been in predicaments like that. But that rigging is very dangerous. You got to really be on your toes and try to stay on them old horses, keep from getting drugged like that with a bareback rigging.
Well, look, I know you're not a one-dimensional cowboy. You just don't ride bronc. You say you break horses, you train. Tell us a little bit about that and how people can get in contact with you.
Oh, I've got people hunting me all the time by the telephone, wanting me to shoe horses, wanting me to train horses, especially horses with bad habits and stuff like that. It's a good deal, you know, kind of local people.
Kind of,
yeah.
Well, look, You are the man. I seen you ride tonight. You're getting it done. And it's such an honor to me to catch up with real guys like you. There's only a few real true cowboys left. What do you think for the sport, for the young generation? What advice you got for the young generation of guys that's trying to get in and do what you do for this long?
Well, I tell you, them young guys, I love them, but they got to put a little more heart in it and try harder and go to some of these schools instead of just, you know, trying to hang on and listen to your buddies. You go to some of these bareback riding, bull riding schools, and you catch up on your fundamentals, and it will help them.
Good deal.
Yeah.
You said a lot, and that's a testament to everybody that's going to be watching this video, is that they just don't do what they do. That's years of practice, hard work, school training, and I'm just so honored to catch up with you, man, and shake your hand one more time. Stanford Moore, Black Reins Magazine, 108 Praise. Such an honor to catch up with True Cowboys. He's representing South Carolina, doing big things. All right? Have a good evening. All right, Stanford Moore, once again, Black Reins Magazine, and honored to be here with 108 Praise Gospel Station. We taking it to the streets. We're actually in Columbus, Georgia right now, the first annual Columbus Black Rodeo. And who do we have here with us today?
My name is Akintunde, comedian, host, Christian comedian, and host for the Black Rodeo. Did it with them in Columbia, South Carolina, where I live. And then they called me and asked me to come out here in Columbus, Georgia. So, hey, man, I'm glad to be here. This is phenomenal. You know, anytime you got black folks, horses and bulls, hair weaves and horses, this is awesome. This is awesome. Phenomenal.
This is awesome. Look, this is phenomenal, right? Akintunde, you can't even go on any radio station today. Yolanda Adams, Martin Show, whatever. Hear the name Akintunde. Now you get to put a face with it. See this cat representing the cowboy hat. Now, I'm a country boy, but I had no idea. I had no idea.
Yes, sir. This is not my normal tie. This is strictly black rodeo tie. You can't wear this jacket nowhere. You can't wear this to church. You can't wear it to the mall. This cat, I wore this in Columbia. I put it in the closet, and I pulled it out for the night. So, hey, second time wearing this, baby.
Good deal. Hey, they knew what they were doing when they brought you in, though, man. You had the crowd rocking.
Well, you know, I had a good time. It was a good crowd. I mean, Columbus came out and supported. It really came out. Thousands and thousands of people came out and supported the Black Rodeo. All the riders. Wonderful. It was, like, really had some good, solid competition this year. So that's what makes it important. What's what makes it great, you know.
Look, man, we at a serious place in the world right now. We see a lot of craziness on the news. Yeah. A lot of people need to laugh, and they need God in a big way.
That's right. That's
absolutely.
Right.
What do you add to that?
Man, I can tell you, man, laughter is a healer. It truly is. It's a physical healer and it's a spiritual healer. And people really got to understand, particularly Christians and people who really call themselves God's people, we really got to understand that it's okay to laugh and have a good time, man. So we out there. We're on the Rebirth of Comedy tour right now. I'm also on a tour right now with Jason Crabb and Ty Tribbett called the Up Close and Personal Tour. And then we have two TV shows that will be coming out, one on USA Network and then another television show that we're still finding a network home for right now. So just look out. The Rebirth of Comedy, clean comedy, a whole different perspective and angle on comedy is coming out really hard in 2016.
Wow, that's a full schedule right there, bro.
God is faithful. You know, when you got five kids and a wife, you know, you got to work. So we, you know, have jokes, we'll travel.
Hey, look, and absolutely, and I mean, they booked you for this show.
Yeah.
You look like you represented the part well.
Hey, let me tell you, if you call me for an all-white event, I'm going to come all-white, okay? If you call me for a black rodeo, Black Rodeo, baby. That's what it is. Blank, blank.
Hey, that's what we do, man. And look, 108 Praise, man, is worldwide, bro. This is going to add thousands of people.
I need 108 Praise to play our music. I'm going to send y'all some comedy. Y'all got to play it. 108 Praise. I'm talking to the camera. I'm looking at the dude behind the camera. I'm telling y'all right now. I need y'all to play this stuff. Please, just please. Most definitely.
Hey, definitely, man. I mean, one of the funniest men in comedy and good, clean Christian comedy, man. What inspired you? Did you always do Christian comedy? Is it something you just evolved in?
No, I was a cussing, straight up cussing comedian. You can see some of my old stuff. And you can tell it's different because I had hair.
Yeah.
If you see with hair, I might be saying something you don't want to hear. But then I got all jokes aside, I got saved in 99.
Oh.
When I got saved, I always say my career got saved 2 years later. So it took about 2 years for me to figure things out. And then it really became a ministry. They really understanding the value of comedy and how it applies to the word, to the body of Christ, and to the world. So we've been, for the past really 13 years, really been diligently serving in churches, touring churches. Churches, whether it's a Sunday morning service or whether it's a special event or a full-blown tour date. Now God is really opening up new doors. us, and that's where these new TV projects are coming out. He's taking us really to a much broader stage and really taking the Word of God with us.
Absolutely, man. That's what we're about. 108 Praise is trying to do that same thing and have that same impact. Love to catch up with guys like you. What do you like to leave the next generation? I mean, there's a lot of people that want to get it. They may be doing bad comedy. When I say bad comedy, it's comedy on the other side. How do you help somebody young, trying to transition, scared to, but transition, step out on faith and transition to this side of comedy?
You know what, man? I can tell you this much. It's real easy to do what everybody else is doing. And a lot of times when God tells you to go and do something his way, it takes a lot of faith to do that. But that's what it takes, faith. It takes faith to make that move. And here's the other thing. There's a faith side of it. There's also a business side. The business side of it, why would you do what everybody else is doing? Right. You want to get what everybody else's results.
Exactly.
And I tell you this much. I can the stuff that's happened for me after getting saved and become a Christian comedian was supposed to happen on the dirty side.
Yeah.
So with the irony thing for me is, well, I have 325 TV writing credits behind the scenes.
Wow.
Wrote on movies and projects. Yeah. Here's the thing. Most of that stuff came after becoming a Christian comedian.
Absolutely.
So there is nobody can tell you that making a decision to do it for God is a bad decision.
Yeah.
God, if you do it his way, he's going to always provide and take care of you. So what I would say to anybody watching, whether it's music, comedy, whether it's radio hosting, television hosting, trust God and make a move.
Absolutely. And look, one thing I want to leave you with, and I want to ask you and see if you can help me out a little bit, being a man, I'm a man's man,
yes, sir,
and I like being that father. I got two young boys at home. I got one grown son.
Yes, sir.
And you saying you have five kids.
Yes, sir.
Talk about what is, you know, just being a good husband, being a good father, good role model. I love seeing these stands packed with just people that look just like us.
Exactly.
Talk about just the manhood and being a dad these days.
The biggest thing we need in America today is quality manhood.
Right.
That's the one thing that's not represented all over the place. Right. You see some of everything else represented, but a good quality old school manhood is not represented. Men who take care of their family, who provide for their children, who correct and protect their children, who raise their children, encourage their children, and also protect their wives and love their wives. That's what we need. That's what's going to turn our communities around.
Absolutely.
Not the government, not some of these other things we think is going to do it. It's going to be us walking our true roles. So, and men, I'm telling you, it's a special blessing when you take care of your family.
Absolutely.
I can tell you that I know it's some things that God did for me, and I truly believe it was the grace of God, and because he knew that I was doing it for my family's sake. So whenever, and also here's another thing, there's a curse that comes along when you don't do it.
Absolutely.
There is a curse for that.
Yeah.
So really, it really truly is us men like yourself, myself, standing up, being the man that our families need to be. We're not perfect, but we're the best mans that we can be, and God honors that.
Hey, man. It's a blessing. I mean, because you just don't find too many men face to face that can say that proudly.
Yeah,
I mean, I seen your hands moving, you look me in the eye, you start talking like you don't touch the nerve now. But I mean, really, man, it's just an honor to see guys like you. And I think it's a dying breed that we can restore through the word.
Well, you know, one thing that needs to happen right now, which is why we're so passionate, we're working on a film project right now. It's called, I'm talking, we just did a deal 2 weeks ago. We're in total development.
This is hush hush.
No, it's not hush hush. You can talk about it because
the deal
to produce it is done. My wife and I are producing it. It's called the Taft Watson Project, tentatively right now. And it's about this gentleman who totally was a coach in South Carolina and, I mean, really was an impactful man.
Wow.
Father to so many. Still living, 94 years old, but when I got this story and saw just not how he was a great coach who won two championships in one day, girls and boys championships in one day.
Whoa.
But behind all of that, great man, great husband, great father. Had struggles in his life, but still a great man, great father. And what God told me was the reason why you're supposed to produce it, because this type of manhood needs to be seen on screen.
Yes.
That's not seen out there. Craziness is seen. Foolishness is seen.
Yes.
But this needs to be seen. So any opportunity, real manhood, quality manhood is raised up. That's what we got to see. It's mandatory. It's in the Word of God, and it's what we need right now as a community and as a country.
Absolutely, and that's what kind of voice we need.
Yes.
We need more of this type of speaking up out on the media outlets, people like yourself to represent laughter, being a man, leading out front, making a difference with a big vision, though.
Yes, sir.
You ain't just riding it out. You got vision in your dreams. Where do you see yourself?
Well, next year, like I said, I got a TV show that's coming out on a major network. We're literally in the process of doing the deal right now. So when that comes out, I need everybody's support, because the more numbers, when people see quality, wholesome stuff get numbers, then they say, well, what else y'all got? Right. And then you can say, hey, man, I know a brother cowboy got a show. I know a radio station got a show. Then the doors can be open, but it has to be supported. So it's a good network. They got a strong foundation, and they're going to put money behind it, and that's what we need. So with that and the movie project, those are the two biggest things in addition to just touring, staying on the road, raising my five children, two of them grown, another one going to college, and I got a beautiful wife who keep me on my toes and keep me on point. So praise the Lord.
Well, absolutely, man. 108 Praise, yes, bunch of listeners, thousands of listeners all across the world. Yes, how can they get in contact with Comedian Akintunde?
Akintunde.net is the website, AKINTUNDE.net. That's the website. And then you also can hit me on Twitter, OkLaughs or Comedian Akintunde, all over the place. That's all of our tags. If you put Comedian Akintunde, we're going to come up.
Absolutely, man. Look. People know now. I mean, this is a stand-up guy. I met him face-to-face. You see his chest stuck out, his head. This is a man's man, ladies and gentlemen. He tackled a crowd of cowboys and outshined them. So we're so honored to catch up with Comedian Akintunde. You see, he ain't the only one got laughs. He makes you laugh. It's infectious. But this guy's a stand-up guy. This is a guy you should book, and we're honored to catch up with him. We're here. 108 Praise. Stand for more. Black Reins TV. All right.